Oh, certified inside documentary right about now, yeah. When I did the last one with the EDN in Coventry, yeah, here's my brethren Claude Hunter that was controlling the camera, so at the start of the video and it was bare blurry. I don't know if he ever really held a camera in his life. Innit? So, thank you Claude. But I was blurry as shit. But anyhow, certified inside documentary, you get me, from CV6 to motherfucking all over the postcodes in London, you get me? What I'm saying is, I got my Uncle Errol here, yeah? Big time boxer from back in the day. Muhammad Ali died, like yesterday, the day before, by the time I filmed this video. Nah, this is a book, you get me? You need to buy that, especially if you're from Coventry, because it'll give you some home truths, and it'll tell you a little bit about the whole boxing scene, when my uncle was growing up and all of that, you get me? I'm going to tell you something about my uncle, yeah. I had six uncles, and they weren't all nice to me. Uncle Errol was always nice to me, and if he wasn't nice to me, he'd call me up and say, you know what, I'm sorry I wasn't that nice to you, innit? But I felt like he deserved it at the time. And I'd be like, why do you think I deserve it? And then he'd be like, yeah, because of this, that, and all, and then be able to speak it out like human beings, people. You know what I mean? Uncle Errol's a champion. He's a champion of the family, very much inspired by Muhammad Ali. And he's going to talk about it a little bit in the documentary. So, what I'm saying to you is, you should watch this video and listen to the documentary. Not even the documentary, it's the interview that I did with me and the Uncle Errol. I got to ask him some stuff. It might put a lot of Coventry onto the history of Coventry, and it might also put a lot of boxing enthusiasts into the career of my Uncle Errol. He's got cancer right now, hence why I wanted to preserve him properly, innit? Because Muhammad Ali just disappeared, and I wanted him back to happen to him. Like, all the people that caught cancer, I'm like, look, why are you? Not Uncle Errol, but life, innit? So, yeah. But he's fighting anyway. He looks really good, as you'll see in the video. He don't look like he's all fucked up. You know what I mean? Like, he's still fighting. He said to me, he told me a long time, no retreat, no surrender, son. So, yeah. He took me to a pub down in the hills. And I sat there and he allowed me to be with me and stuff. So, enjoy, yeah. Certified inside, mini B. Download that love yourself out. Straight out of CLV, back in the LD, and doing what I need to do, doing what I'm supposed to be.
Right, with respect, our next guest is one of the most talented fighters we have ever produced, never to win a major pro title. Welcome to the show, Errol Christie.
Thank you.
Welcome to the show. Is that a compliment, or is that the sort of thing you don't want to attach to your name? The best fighter ever not to have won the British title?
I don't really attach anything to it. I mean, it was a sign of the times. I think I was born at the wrong time.
Very fair point. It's one of those things, isn't it? You have that conversation in the pub, and you talk about the best guys never to win, the best guys are the worst guys to win world titles, which is that as a competition last week.
Yeah.
But your name always comes to the top of the pile, most talented out there.
Yeah, I'm very surprised by that, because people still do remember me for some reason.
Well, it's a record book. It's a Guinness Book of Records part of it, Errol.
Yeah.
I mean, what you have to understand here is, if Errol won't blow his own trumpet, I will, is that by the time Errol turned professional, he'd won the whole 10 titles that you could win, the European under 19. So he'd won 4 schoolboy titles, 3 NABC titles, 2 junior ABA titles, the full senior title, and then the European under 19.
All right, Uncle Errol. This is my Uncle Errol, champion boxer. When was he the British champion, Uncle Errol?
I remember British champion, or champion of England, amateur. You go back into the 80s.
Mm-hmm. And they had you on ITV. You was on the ITV boxing.
Yeah, fight night.
It was on Fight Night. Fight Night. When was that? That was like...
That was in the 80s.
Late 80s, early 90s, wasn't it?
Yeah, I came in 81. I come on the scene in 1981. Come to London, from Coventry, came to London, fighting. I fought my way into London.
Mm-hmm.
At Wembley. And Harry Carpenter, the great sports commentator of the day, said the star is born. That was 1981.
Okay. So just for people that don't know, when did you start and why did you start?
Back in the day, you know, it was the only black family on our street, a street of family of boys. There were about five of us at the time. And the area was quite run down at times, and the factory, Standard Triumph, they had a boxing club for their workers. They allowed the kids to come off the street and train the club for free. If we had to pay, we wouldn't have done it.
Okay. That's at the Stand-Up Triumph, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. Cat Marty Road, just round the corner from my house. My house was in the right area at the right time.
And how old were you when you went there first?
I think I was about 9, 10. And the first time I was 10.
So you've been training since you was 10 years old?
Yeah. All right. I've been training before that.
So how did you get into the Stand-Up Triumph?
Well, I was lucky that it was just luck. My parents, we all lived in a small house in Coventry, and there was always something going on. There was always screaming and shouting, and it was a way to get away from all that. My brothers found a gym. It was just on the corner on our street. We went there. We started boxing. Us, we stuck there. We became a family at the gym.
So, which one of your brothers was the one that took you there first?
It was Michael, my brother Michael, my big brother Michael, who
Uncle Mike,
who found the gym.
Okay, so what do you think it was that gave you that fighting spirit? What made you want to fight? Obviously, through the family history, I know that some of it was to do with, you know, because you lot had all the boot boys and all of that chasing you over, innit?
They worked on our stamina. They helped us with our stamina, our fitness.
So, was it just an outlet, or is it because you was kind of getting yourself ready for the next fight when you was on the road?
No, we loved it. My dad loved Cassius Clay.
Mm-hmm. R.I.P.
Yeah, he loved Cassius Clay. Graham Hondali, he just passed away. My dad was his biggest fan, one of his biggest fans, and like my dad just loved fighting, and then we're just so lucky that there's a club, a boxing club, around the corner from the house.
So
we're just lucky.
So when you started, like, what was your first fight like? Did you win that fight? Do you remember it?
I won all my fights.
You won all your fights?
I got a decision against me once in a fight.
Yeah.
But that was squashed, so I never lost no amateur fight.
So your first fight was that in Coventry?
Yeah, Coventry, yeah.
Wait, in the Triumph?
In Triumph, yeah. Triumph Gym, Tar Hill.
Okay.
The place called Tar Hill.
Yeah, because they've got the new Triumph Gym is up there now.
Yeah.
It's all up there now. What were your favourite moments of boxing?
So most boxing, like just being on the road with loads of guys, like, because back in the day, it was a very racial time. It was just a relief. My mum was frightened of us going on the street because we would get attacked. We was getting attacked all the time and being abused, verbally abused by people, calling out all the wog and nigger and all that sort of thing. It was all around. And my mum was just trying to find a place where we could go with it all without being hassled.
What was it like for you lot in Coventry at that time?
I always say I never minded it, because I just seemed to like fighting. I was always in a fight. Every day, you know, I was coming out with my shirt torn and my jumper ripped. It was always something. I was always in a fight. And so the boxing was just another expression of that.
Was it always racially motivated, or yeah, was it all pretty much always racially motivated?
It was racially.
So what were they saying to you? Because like my thing about what I do is, I want to tell my generation about what happened with the previous generation, so they don't sit there chatting a load of shit like they know everything. Do you understand what I mean? So you got to tell them, especially people in Coventry, you got to tell them how lucky they are about how it's a lot calmer in Coventry right now.
And like back in the day, they'd be taking the mickey, they're making all the monkey noises and stuff like that, and they'll be chanting, they'll be screaming face at you and stuff. You know, it wasn't nice. It was a horrible time.
Yeah.
Growing up, I mean, I only found peace. I was always in Coventry. I was always fighting. I had scars on my hands. I've even got scars, old scars from the old days on my hands. I was always fighting. I was always in a fight.
So do you have a good story about one of the early fights before you was a boxer? that kind of let you know that this is what I like doing.
I was just always fighting, so when I was doing the boxing club, we had a rest every minute and a half. We had a little rest, calm down, sit down, breathe and all that. But when street fight, you just fought till the guy dropped.
Yeah. Because I used to get all the stories growing up, you know what I mean? Like, what about that guy where you told me you punched somebody and either his tooth came out in your knuckle?
Yeah, I still got the mark. I think the ear is just, that's it.
With that one there?
Yeah. That's where I took the tooth out.
So what happened there?
I give it him back.
Did you give it him back?
Yeah, give it him back. Put his tooth back. I didn't want it.
What about that? What was that story you told me that one time where you punched the guy and he fell over, but he fell over like 2 minutes too late? That delayed reaction.
He fell over 2 minutes. I whacked him, but he went to throw punch, but he just dropped.
Yeah.
He went to retaliate, but he just fell over. Just that, he was gone.
Where was this? Down by the pilot?
Jimmy Cousin, from the house, from Jimmy Cousin, that's where all the guys are drinking the pub.
Mm-hmm.
The pilot pub where they used to come out of the pub and start chasing his man, calling his name and stuff like that. He was always running.
So would you say Coventry was a big National Front stronghold back in the day?
Yeah. It was very racist.
How did the National Front affect, like, what was it that you saw? Like, did you see them a lot and, like...
There were skinheads, it was skinhead day. Skinheads were out all the time.
Mm-hmm. Whereabouts would they normally go? Like, where did you normally see them?
Our park, just 2 steps away from the house, was a park, Radford Park.
Mm.
Radford Road Park, they was there. Everyone walked to the Crescent, to Chippy, they was there. They was everywhere.
Try and explain a little bit about what it felt like to walk around and see that kind of stuff regularly.
Not regularly. You're not just walking around and seeing it. You've been chased. We used to get chased all the time by the... We could never be walking, we'd all be running.
200 niggas, you should have shot 200 skinheads out there with kit fire.
Mm-hmm.
But I like to think it helped with my stamina.
You made the best out of a bad situation.
Yeah. We just did a fully suit, it helped with the fitness and all that. You know, we tolerated it. And it helped us get practice in.
So, like, you see, when you was growing up, like, out of all the uncles, like, they the people that I put this video out to, they're not going to know the whole family and stuff like that, but, like, who was with you the most, like, out of your brothers?
At that time, I think Andy more. I was more like the Andy.
Hmm.
You growing up.
Okay. So, how old were you, and what do you remember about the first time when you realised, like, yeah, I'm Errol Christie, the big boxer from Coventry?
No, I never thought I was a big boxer. I never thought I'd go to the boxing club and all that.
Yeah.
But I never saw myself as a big boxer. I was winning titles. I say I was blessed because I was at that club.
Mm-hmm.
Tom and Gary, the secretary of the club, he seen that I could fight, and he helped me. He took me on all the trips. These was fighting all over the country. Wales, Digby, Newcastle. I couldn't get to those places without Tom McGarry.
So tell us about Tom McGarry, because Tom McGarry is he's a legend. People know his name, but they don't know his name. Yeah.
Tom McGarry was a Scotchman, and he used to say, Errol, you see here, you know, you get it. They call you black this and that and that. It's the same thing as us. No blacks, no Scottish, no Irish, you know, like, they had all that stuff. So he was going through some of the same stuff I was going to say, but he was more white, so I wouldn't say he got as heavy as I did.
Yeah.
But you get some.
Because there's that thing, like, the way that I look at it is just like, obviously, the Irish and the Scottish and different people that are English, they get it,
yeah.
But like, they can pretend to be English if they want to be.
Yeah, that's right. They can just keep their mouth shut.
Yeah. If you keep your mouth shut and talk in a good British accent, you're all right, innit? But you can't disguise black.
Yeah, you can't disguise black.
You can't disguise black.
You've got to fight.
You've
got to fight your way out.
Was he like one of the first white people that you met in your life where you was like, you know what, he understands where I'm coming from?
Yeah, he was good, man. He knew the score. Because he always used to say all the time, and it's not just you that gets it, you know. It says no blacks, no Scotch, no that. He went through the whole lot. He knew the score, Tom knew the score.
Mm.
He gave me the key to at this big massive factory, and they give me the keys to the factory. This big working man's club. Mm. And I had the keys to go to the gym. I could go to the gym and train anytime I wanted.
Whenever you wanted.
Whenever I wanted.
That's really good, man.
You know, I moved into the gym. I was given freedom to use it.
So how often do you feel like you went to the gym? Was you pretty much there if you weren't at home?
I was there all the time, yeah, I was in the gym.
If you weren't at home, you was in the gym?
I was in the gym.
So you weren't really, like, all on the road and everything with everybody else?
I still have to work.
So you didn't really get mixed up in any...
Nah.
My thing,
because I looked up people like Muhammad Ali, just passed away now, but he was my hero back in the day.
Yeah.
Muhammad Ali, he was the sort of guy that I looked up to them times.
So tell them about Grandad and his reaction to Muhammad Ali, because obviously...
Cassius.
Is that what Grandad used to call him?
Cassius.
Because, obviously, like, for people that don't know, Grandad didn't talk that much, did he?
Nah, he had some battles.
Yeah.
He had some real wars. He's come on with his knuckles all tore up, his shirt ripped off, everything.
Yeah.
He didn't say no crap for nobody.
Nah, you could tell.
So
when he saw Muhammad Ali, he was happy to see, like, somebody standing up.
Muhammad Ali was the... He was our heroes back in the day,
mm-hmm.
And he could not just fight, but he could talk.
He could speak for himself.
That's right. He was a man.
He didn't take any crap.
Nah, mate.
So Grandad never took any crap either.
Didn't take no crap.
Do you think that Muhammad Ali probably inspired Grandad as well?
Cassius. My dad's name was Cassius.
So he'd sit down there quiet, and then you know there was a fight coming on, just come turn on the TV and tell everybody for shut up.
Yeah, man, when Cassius was on, mate, there was no noise in the house, man.
That was probably the only time when you were sitting there and all watching the TV together and just chilling, innit?
Yeah, when Cassius come on, there were
days. On the old black and white?
Yeah, mate. And North Coventry was proper Germans and proper racists back in that day.
Mm.
They'd drive the cars at you across the road, and my mum used to be frightened that we might not get home okay, because they'd drive the cars at you and all that.
On the account that you're black.
Yeah.
Coloured people, if you ask me, after the experiences I've had of them, I've had my belly full of them, I can tell you. If you ask me what should be done with them, I'll tell you now. You can get them all out of the country, and as soon as you can get them out, the better I'll be pleased. I'll tell you that.
They're a nuisance when you've got to walk past them in the streets. They won't move. They're a nuisance at work. They won't work. And for folks who got them living by them, they're a nuisance, more nuisance still.
Well, I think it's pretty awful. I think they should live in a district all to themselves, because I've got to bring this little boy up amongst them, and they're not clean, and the smell of the cooking makes you feel sick. You get the smell of the cooking upstairs in the bedrooms.
And you all get called out.
Something like...
Yeah, blackie, niggas, all the time.
All the time. So, would you say that Radford at that time was pretty much...
Yeah, you could always hear the black family on the street. There was on our street, there was three black families at the time.
Mm-hmm.
There was the Jarretts, but they were a family of girls, so they never really came out. Mm. All the other family were there, there was eight of us.
There was a lot of boys.
Yeah, we had a lot of boys. So
there was definitely a lot of boys. Six boys, two girls.
Yeah, and we had the skinners used to be chasing us always down that street.
Because you went to Hill Farm, didn't you?
Yeah, Hill Farm, yeah.
I went to Hill Farm for a bit, so... Like, I used to think that some of the lads that were racist to me, I used to think... Obviously, they're the children and the kids that used to be racist to you, innit?
Yeah, pop-up.
Do you know what I mean? Like, so they got a bit of a Christie grudge, ain't they?
It wasn't just the kids, though, it was the parents, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The parents, all of it.
Were there people that were racist to you when they were younger that got older and realised that they were being twats and approached you differently?
I don't know, because I got to come as soon as I could get out of there, I got out of there.
Yeah.
I got to London, I got down here when I was about... I got picked for England, so I was fighting for England at the time. So I was at Crystal Palace.
Okay. So when you got picked for England and that, and you started going about, like... can you remember the fights and what fights you had and where.
Yeah, I fought Germany. I mean, remember I was in Germany, I was fighting with the Germans.
You fought in Germany?
Yeah, I fought in Germany.
Literally?
In Schirin, I was in Germany. And the Germans, I thought Germans would be like them racist things you see on TV and that. Mm. They weren't like that at all.
Yeah.
They welcomed me.
For younger, what would you want to tell younger black people that are kind of going through certain, I'm talking about, you know, a lot of people, because not everybody, one thing that I've noticed about my generation is that a lot of people, this is just my opinion, innit, so if anybody thinks I'm wrong, then I'm wrong, innit, but, you know, I think that there's a lot of fighters that have that kind of spirit that you had, but you was lucky because you got into the boxing and stuff like that, they got you out. But then in my generation, I feel like because they don't have that kind of outlet, they end up in the whole gang thing.
Yeah, that's why.
Do you know what I mean?
That's why I always say that I was blessed, because just round the corner from the house, there was a gym.
Yeah.
And everyone trained there, everyone got on well, everyone, you know, like, there might be some Germans there, but you wouldn't have known. They never showed that part of them.
Yeah.
But everyone got on well. We were trying to get out. We were sparring because I could take care of myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I was lucky in that way that I never got no one to try and come and abuse me. Take liberties with me, like try and give me some knockout shots and all that.
I
didn't take the liberties with anybody.
Respectful.
I respect my fellow fighters and stuff.
Mm.
And we had that camaraderie.
Yeah.
And it went out in the street as well. We were the best of pals in that gym.
Mm. So, alright, I may ask you something just totally out there, like, what do you think about boxing now? Who are you watching and who are you interested in and who are you not interested in and all kind of crap like that?
I don't really watch the fight now. The only fighters are interested in me back in the day were people like Muhammad Ali. I was fan of Muhammad Ali. I was fan of Joe Frazier, you know what I mean?
Mm.
All them fighters back in the day.
The old school.
I was like, that's what...
So do you look into, like, David Haye and all of that? And...
Yeah, I respect David Haye and all these fighters. I respect all my fighters. I respect all my fellow fighters.
Mm.
I respect them all. But the fight that's day in my mind, people like Shire Leonard, Muhammad Ali, you know, these are the guys that I have a lot of respect for.
Why would you say that? Is it because of what they were doing at the time as well?
Yeah, Muhammad, he tried to help his people, you know, tried to school his people, he does so much. Mm. He's a kind guy, and I like to think that I was the same. Mm. Like when I was boxing, I never let things get in your head, like, become a big, play the big star part of it.
Mm.
Just be a normal person.
Could you talk a little bit about the whole Mark Kayla thing? Like, because they got the photos on the internet there of, you know, remember when he was in the newspaper when you knocked him out on the press conference and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But obviously, I've read the book, but I knew the story before I even had the book. You know what I mean? Like, but when he was in the book and you had the fight, it sounded like there was a whole load of intimidation going on before you even got in the room, before you even got in the ring, because you was outnumbered, weren't you? What football firm was watching him? Was it Millwall or West Ham or...?
It was West Ham and Millwall and all that. Was
and you said that only a few people from Coventry could come and support you, innit?
Yeah, only a few would come, yeah. There was a bit intimidating.
How did the reputation of the sport survive outside the ring at Wembley? Well, big fight interest, but fears of trouble prevented a full house. The extra security seemed to work, though. That combined with a complete ban on alcohol. It was soft drinks only for the fight faithful, but they seemed to enjoy it. Terry Lawless had brought in his own security men to keep control of Kayla's volatile fans.
I got in touch with several people that I know that go to the football grounds and things like that, and we employed a firm to just keep things calm.
They know the troublemakers,
and we just mingle them in the audience to make sure that they stopped anything before it starts.
So what was that like? Because, like, when I imagine that, I feel myself thinking, I'm walking in there, I'm Errol Christie, I know I'm a champion, but, like, you're looking around and it's like sick, like, a million people, and you're just like, I'm Errol Christie, I'm a champion, but I can't fight everybody in this room.
No, you don't look at it like that, you're just getting there.
And do your job.
Yeah, you're programmed, you're getting there and just do your fight, you know what I mean? You're programmed to get there and do your stuff. But I always had on the outside that there was that thing, that racist thing that was going on.
Yeah.
In the background, the whole time I fight was that I was surrounded by the enemy, I was surrounded by the Germans.
Because you went in there and you said that somebody that for firework or something like that, isn't it?
Fireworks, there's loads of stuff that was going on.
The odd banger was all that disturbed the peace. A happy outcome for promoter Mike Barrett.
The crowd behaved very well. And I'm intent on seeing that as far as the shows I'm concerned with will continue like that. Because we must make quite sure that the people who buy tickets can come in, sit down in comfort, and not be harassed by hooligans and stupid people.
Because there was a lot of police there as well.
Yeah, there was police. There was police everywhere.
Did you see? You've never seen that before in a boxing match, have you? That amount of police presence?
Yeah, there's all in uniform, all in uniform, the hats.
And yeah.
Never see that before.
No. Why do you think they did that?
Because the Germans were there, the Germans.
So do you think Mark Kayla kind of represented for that side? Yeah. That was like two tribes going to war, weren't it?
Yeah, that was his side, yeah. That was his side.
So, like, obviously, that was the one fight where, you didn't win that fight, but, like, how did that make you feel? Did that piss you off?
Yeah, big time. Big time.
Yeah, man.
Like, big time. Big time.
I feel, this is just my personal opinion, I feel like you might have lost the battle, but you won the war, in a way. So that's just, you know what I mean? Like, but.
Yeah. It's a fight.
Yeah.
When I lost the fight, you know. It's...
What happened in the newspaper clipping where you and him nearly had a thing before the fight even happened? You know, and then when they put you in the newspaper, that famous picture where you.
Yeah, with a punch up at the press conference.
Yeah. What happened there?
No, because he was just a German, the way he come at me and all that. Like, they were just Germans, just the enemy, you know. He was what I grew up fighting against all my life. I was a young kid.
Yeah.
Like, that was him. That was it there, in front of me.
It was almost like they confronted you with everything.
Yeah. It was all coming at me, you know.
Yeah.
But the people didn't know what was going on. But I knew what was going on. I was surrounded by the Germans, by the enemy. Even the referee, everybody was on their side. It was a black v white thing.
Yeah. It was, weren't it? That's what I think that fight was. That was literally like it was like the great black hope versus the great white hope.
Yeah, that's what it was, yeah.
Like Jack Johnson, innit? When he went down to Australia, innit? Yeah, that's what it was like, weren't it?
It was, yeah. And like, everybody was on his side, you know? He was like, the referee, everybody was on that side.
So what was it like? Boxing, because Grandma went to a lot of the boxes, weren't it?
She went to
a couple of them, didn't she?
Yeah,
the way she was giving you all the worry talk, innit?
I never really spoke to my mum when I was fighting.
After the fight?
After the fight, yeah. She never interfered in
the... There's a picture that I shared on my Instagram that I found that I think Louis shared it. Of Mike Tyson reading your book.
Right, yeah.
Did you meet Mike?
Yeah.
What was he like?
He was all right, it's nice. We never had much time, just was quick meet, just hello and that.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're all fighters.
Yeah.
You know, we know what we had to go through.
How did you feel about Tyson? Do you reckon you could knock him out? Back in them days.
Well, when I was in my prime.
When he was in your prime?
Yeah, and I was dreaming.
What about this little rumour that people used to throw around, they used to try and say that you had a glass jaw? What is that? That's bollocks, isn't it?
That's crap. That was crap.
Because how much fights did you win?
I won loads of fights. Only the last two fights I got knocked out. I never counted out for a count of 10.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Like, these were like proper real blood, real gritty fights. These ain't no like little...
Yeah.
Humdingers, mate.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I get ya. So, like, So you fought people from different places, so like...
All over the world, I fought all...
What were some of your favourite fights?
Like, real favorite fights,
I don't mean favorite like you, like you, like you're overly pride in them, but like, you know, where you felt like you did a good job when you came out, like.
Yeah, well, most of my fights I felt like they were good boxing fights, you know. But like, yeah, you know, with the Kenner fight, the referee was a dodgy referee, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There was loads of shit that was going on that night.
Yeah.
You know, but. What can you do? Like, you know, they're the officials, you know what I mean? What can you do?
So when you finished boxing, you did a couple other little ventures. You did a fashion thing for a bit.
Yeah, I've done fucking.
And then you was selling things at, what's that place that you was at?
The market, just here.
Down the market, down here in Lewisham.
Yeah, I was in there, that's what kept me going to market.
So, tell us a little bit about what you got up to when you were done, when you was finished with the whole boxing thing.
Well, normal thing people do, go to work.
It's just got to work, innit?
Yeah, just go to work.
My main thing as well is that it's a black experience that I'm sharing. You get me? It's not just you that I'm going to do this with, it's other people that I know that have got stories that can tell the real what's been happening, you know what I mean? Like, so, like, what was it like at Hill Farm when you was a kid? Obviously you've said that they were a certain way and that, but is there like an instance where you kind of realise, like, I don't like this. This is bollocks.
I
mean,
I know there were problems with Hill Farm.
Yeah.
Hill Farm was all right. Normal school kids, normal kids. I didn't really pay attention to any crap going on, but I was a sports person, so I was playing football. They loved me at Hill Farm because I played football. They made me their captain and everything.
Yeah.
So they treated me good. School treated me good.
You remember when Roots came out, the original one?
Yeah, Roots.
What was that like?
Yeah, the boys are going to chuck the floor from all that. Yeah, the boys are going to chuck the floor. Yeah, I said, I ain't no slave. We had loads of fights over that.
Yeah. Because I heard that when Roots came out, like, it was literally awkward to go to school, weren't it? Like, proper, like...
They called me Kunta Kinte.
Kunta Kinte.
Yeah, Kunta Kinte. I got a new name.
Yeah. Toby.
Cool. I had a new name when Fanny Apes came out. They called me Uncle Errol.
Yeah.
There was all these programs that came on TV, I got my name changed all the time.
Yeah. So, would you say that things got a little bit more realer for you when you left school? Was it like PK times when you began to realise that people were being a little bit worse? Is that President Kennedy or...?
Yeah, President Kennedy, my secondary school, that's when I knew that's when I've done the most fighting.
At President Kennedy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because the kids, they've watched a new program come out, like Kunta Kinte and all these programs would come out, your name would change.
Yeah.
Like, it'd be called Urko.
Yeah.
And all the names would change. Whatever program came out, I'd be called that name.
So, another good question, I think, is obviously a lot of black people that remember that time, well, maybe not a lot, maybe more than, maybe I think it's a lot because of the people that I know, but like, you know, obviously they think. They don't talk to white people, I don't know white people this and white people that.
Yeah.
Like, but were there people, like white people and different people that were all right?
Yeah, there was loads of them, like, some good, some I felt sorry for them really, because they get treated bad and they were good people. There was loads of good white people out there, there was loads of them. But like, back in my time, I didn't want no white friends or nothing like that. I didn't have no white friends. I did have a few good ones that I needed for, like, any special rule things, but there was all right. I didn't mind all that crap.
Yeah.
Well, take a joke.
What was it? Some of it was like banter, innit?
Yeah, banter. That's what they call it, banter.
Because you don't want to be too sensitive, do you?
You've
got to have a laugh, innit? Yeah.
If you get too serious, mate, you're not going to go nowhere, mate. You should be fine every day.
Yeah. So, there's another thing that you used to talk about, and like, you mentioned it in the book as well. What was it like going out clubbing?
Clubbing is a different thing. To get in the club, I was fighting bouncers first and all that. I was really fighting. And then they just let me on because I was just trouble. They seemed as trouble and they knew that I could fight. So They didn't want to mess with me, so like, I was all right.
Yeah. So in Cove, obviously, like, one of the main things that I look up to you for is that, obviously, with the amount of racism that was happening, obviously, you and certain of the other uncles, you know, used to fight it physically, do you know what I mean? Like, yeah. You know, with all of that fighting and stuff, like, how much people in your community, because you were one of three black families on the street,
yeah.
But you weren't the only black family in Coventry at the time. So do you feel like there was a lot of people that was with you, or do you feel like it was kind of like used like championing this thing? Do you feel like you had your black community behind you at that time?
Not really, because a lot of them, the parents didn't want to hang around the Christians. The Christians was a bad name back in the day.
Yeah.
We never took no crap from nobody. We started fighting.
Yeah.
So the Christian name was a bad thing back in the day. We were all fighters.
What other names were they afraid of back then? Was it just mainly used lot?
Yeah, the Christians. The Christians was well known by the authorities, by the police, anything.
The police used to arrest you quite a lot back in the day. What kind of little shit things they used to? What were they used to arrest you for?
Me, I only got arrested for fighting.
27% of the crime was committed by blacks.
Yeah.
I was always fighting.
Where would you say the worst spots for you to go to were back in them days in Coventry?
Tiffany's in town. Tiffany's the nightclub.
Tiffany's.
Yeah. To knock out the bastards and that. There's some good fights in there.
What about the pilot? The pilot weren't that nice, was it?
You didn't live in the pilot, that's all Germans up there.
Yeah.
The pub that's that pub, the pilot pub, never go there.
Yeah.
Jimmy Christian, all around there, all Germans.
When you was fighting the bouncers and stuff, what kind of stuff? Why were they stopping? Obviously, they were stopping you because you was black, but like, they'd come
charges
up.
Your charges were too short. We've got long socks on, any little excuse so we can try to block us from going in the club. Any excuse they give.
So they had a thing as well, where I know in Wolverhampton, there was something happening in Wolverhampton a long, long time ago before I was born. And they was having like these little rallies and stuff with the black people and the Indian people. Yeah. So like, were there Indian people as well with you that was kind of like?
Yeah, but you have a few. But a few of them, we never had many Asian friends.
Mm-hmm.
It was just lately, my younger Andy's age, you start getting more Asian friends coming around with it, but my lot, we never had no real Asian friends.
Mm-hmm.
A few years later, they started coming out of their shell a bit more,
mm-hmm.
But they kept themselves to themselves.
Mm. When you got famous per se, or a bit of notoriety in Coventry, did people change towards you?
They didn't, because people never recognised me. Is anyone that's tumbled on down and that? And then someone called Errol, Errol, someone called Jack Shine, Errol, Errol, what are you doing? That's Errol. I remember saying this one got 9 over here.
Yeah.
But she was on the floor. You know what I mean?
Grandma used to tell me that, like, you know, like when some of the racist kids used to come around and they used to try to terrorise the house and that.
Yeah.
I heard granddad had to chase them off a few times.
They were all small, but they were young. They were big skinheads.
Yeah.
They were big people.
So have you got like at least one story about when granddad just had enough and just went out?
No, he just had been. They just ran into him. Like, he's like running into a brick wall. The old man just stood there, mate. They couldn't budge him.
They couldn't budge him, innit?
Nah, man. They start running the other way.
Do you think that a lot of the reasons why they tried to mess with yous was because they were kind of intimidated by granddad? Because granddad was literally made of concrete, weren't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, finish what you were saying. There was quite a lot of white kids.
Yeah, they was all right. That's a good friends, man. You know, they
try to
drag you away from all
that. Yeah. Did you ever have moments where you'd have a fight or you'd have an argument with somebody who is obviously a racist And then, like, you
GM,
go...
GM, I call him GM.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But, like, and then you had a white mate, and then you take it out on him, or you... Or, like, he turned around and say something to you and be like, it's just not, don't pay attention to him and all that
crap. I was lucky I never had nothing like that. I've got my good friends, I know who my friends are. That's a good wife.
Who was your manager after, well, who was the guy after Tom McGarry?
Well, I mean, London, from out there, Kent.
Okay.
McCarthy.
What did you enjoy most about boxing? What do you enjoy most about boxing?
I enjoyed boxing. We could go and win all right. We met some nice people. And not everybody's the same. Boxing was a great lesson teacher.
Do you think it taught you that not to tar everybody with the same brush and all that?
Definitely.
Yeah.
Big time.
Do you ever feel like there was any point in your career that you got ripped off?
We all got done.
Because like, obviously I make music and stuff like that. You know, I get older people like, be careful because they'll rip you off. I'm thinking, well, they was ripping everybody off, weren't they?
Yeah, back in them times, you don't know the school life of being. Just not all getting money, I could go and get my stuff. I didn't give a crap at the time. But we never knew. I'd come from a place where we didn't know about them percentages and all that.
Yeah. You're just happy to get some money, innit?
You know where I come from.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Because just long as we're getting ahead, that's the main thing. The only thing that didn't really bother me. They couldn't make me fall. I'm
saying you've
been down there.
Yeah. It's like, so when you get some money, it's like, thank you.
Yeah, you can afford that loan and the loan.
Because one of your first cars that you bought when you got a bit of money, you bought a Porsche, didn't you?
The first one was a Stag.
Triumph Stag.
The Porsche when I come to London.
Yeah.
When they come to London, they had the Stag. And then when I come to London, it's a Porsche.
Do you get pulled over a lot?
Yeah, all the time.
Alright, you see, like, traffic light. Hello, mate, what are you doing with that?
You
must have thought you was a drug dealer or something, innit? What happened with the
pimp?
You was a pimp.
Yeah. A drug dealer and a pimp.
Yeah. So, the fashion thing, what happened with the fashion thing then?
I was trying to do stuff. I did some fashion shows. I tried loads of stuff. I was hustling.
You met Mad Frank, didn't you?
Mad Frankie Fraser.
Mad Frankie Fraser, how was that?
Little old-time gangster. It's only about this big.
Yeah.
You know, he's only small
little
man. Yeah. Dangerous geezer.
Yeah.
You see the eyes,
he
got evil eyes.
You can tell, I saw that interview. And
well, I've always heard about Frankie back in those days. I mean, I was just at we was training Thomas and Beckett, the old Kent Road, and like your name was like, you was one of the boys down there. You had a reputation that was on the street. They really had a lot of respect for you, not taking no crap from nobody. Back in them days as well, we couldn't get no jobs, A lot of that time, there never really a lot of respect for black guys. We were supposed to be cleaners, really, cleaners and whatever. And we was in a fight, and there was always that black v white thing that was kicking out at time.
With all the best boxers, really, were all black, weren't they? No, you can't. No good ignoring it. It's true, without a doubt. Always. And that's always. Look at Joe Louis. You couldn't have had a better man than him, could you? God blimey, beat everyone.
For the only way for a black guy to come through back in them days, sort of,
was through boxing,
that's right. That's the only way we got a break back in the days, through fighting.
It was like a way of getting out of the gutter, wasn't it? That was everyone's ambition, either boxer or footballer or something. I choose something different. The only trouble with mine was it always led to the Old Bailey.
Back when I met you, I wasn't doing too bad when I met you.
No, he was doing good, very good.
It was a little bit after that when I started going down.
In today's world of boxing, he'd have been a champion all over, no worries. He was good. There's no way Bert McCarthy and Leslie had been involved with him if he hadn't have been. He was good. You must remember, I was convicted with Frank Warren's uncle, Bobby Warren, in the Spot case. Bobby Warren was absolutely innocent. Absolutely. He got 7 years with me. Oh, terrific guy. That's how Bert and that got into the boxing, through Bob, really. Everybody loved boxing then, didn't they? Whether you were a gangster or whatever, that was it. Of course, they don't have boxing in schools now. I don't think they're allowed,
Yes, it was banned. When I was at school, they banned it.
Oh, blimey.
They banned it. They should bring it back.
They should do. That was wonderful when we was at school. You couldn't get in that ring and box quick enough. It was wonderful. You know, it was good for the kids, wasn't it?
Yeah. Teach them discipline.
Yeah, it's right there. Gives it everything. Yeah. The only trouble was I always cheated. I always had a lump of lead in my glove. He didn't need it.
1-2, double jab cross.
Don't make me laugh. It's good. Don't make me laugh.
We've got to get them punches in.
That's terrific, that. It's good, isn't it?
Because, you know, like, every now and again, like, obviously, like, part of the reason why I'm filming this is, like, I feel like you should be like where Ian Wright is right now. Like, obviously, Ian Wright was a big footballer and that, and like he gets to host shows every now and again and do stuff like that. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, but like, you've done a few interviews and that. Like, what's that like? How's that feel like to be invited to certain places to talk about your experiences, to talk about, you know, boxing or whatever? You know, like.
It's a great thing. It's nice. So talk about how you talk about boxing for ages.
Mm.
Yeah, boxing for me was a passport.
Yeah, yeah.
It was a way out of where I was.
Yeah.
I wasn't really old, really. You know, I was trying everything. I was always a worker. I always worked and I used to live in a stuff. But it just wouldn't add up to anything to me. But boxing helped me move on.
So what do you think about racism now? Like, do you feel like it's... Obviously, like you said earlier, like certain things have improved, but do you think it's gone?
No, it will never go. As long as different people will always be there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There's nothing you can do about it.
But do you think it's worth overly stressing about it, or do you just see it as a thing that you just got to keep fighting through?
Yeah, don't ever stress about it. Just can't let it get to you. Just do your thing. There's always different things in the world, different people, different colours, different everything. So you just got to get on with it. Just try not to let it bother you too much.
Mm-hmm.
Just, you know, if you treat people good, they treat you good, you don't go that way. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, do you mind talking a little bit about what's happening with you now with this whole cancer thing? Like, what's actually happening with that? Like, where is it affecting you?
Oh, I want to go to it, you know, because I don't know myself.
Yeah, yeah.
All I know is that I'm being treated for it, and, you know, I'm getting chemo and I'm being radiotherapy and all that.
You look pretty good considering, though.
Yeah, that's what you say, so all I can do is thank God that I'm still here.
Yeah.
You know, I can't complain.
How did it feel when you found out that you got it? Was you kind of like...
What made me bitter about it was that I've got it from secondhand cigarette smoke.
Secondhand?
Secondhand cigarette smoke.
From when you was in the boxing clubs and all that?
Yeah, yeah. Passive smoking.
Because you've never smoked, have you?
Never smoked. We used to do a thing at school where we should get a fag. I had the fag. By some kids and say, look, do you want a drink?
Yeah.
And the guy said, yeah, we throw him on the floor and drag him around the field. we have chucked the flag, you want a drink, mate? And we drag him, we throw him on the floor and drag him around the field. That's near as I got to a and then it got me in the end.
So how did you deal with peer pressure? Or did you just never give a fuck?
I don't give a crap. Just get in there and do your thing, get out. Stuff, you know,
getting the hell out of there. Mm. So, I know that right about now, like, things are how they are, you know what I mean? Like, but do you have any plans for anything else? Like, if you could, would you do something else? Like, because I remember you wanted to do some theatre stuff and all kind of stuff, didn't you?
Yeah, whatever, I mean, like, once I finish my treatment, I'd be looking to do something.
Mm.
God willing.
Yeah, God willing.
God's given the power to do that.
As grandma would say, if the Lord give me strength.
Yeah, if the Lord, that's right. If the Lord give me strength, we will do it.
Yeah, man.
You know what I'm saying? Who knows, man? Who knows?
Yeah.
Who knows what's in the future? Retreat, no retreat, no surrender. The battle must go on.
All the time, don't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
All right, Uncle Errol, man. Thank you very much for the interview, man. Bless.
I'm telling you, he's one of God. He was like my hero. We loved him, you know. He was the reason why I became a fighter. He's not doing all these shuffles. And he's cursed me up in the ring back that Christie's obviously don't do all these shuffles and all that. Those were great days, great memories, man. He's left some great memories in my mind. Always loved that man.
Rest in paradise, Muhammad Ali.
Rest in paradise.